Everybody say my name. You're not the last one. I think that's everybody. Good evening, everybody. Glad y'all are here. I know it's the Sunday night before Thanksgiving, and usually Sunday evenings are kind of one of those times when, you know, folks want to have church but don't often want to come to church. You know what I mean? And especially on a night before a holiday or Sunday night before a holiday, I know how important it is for you to be with your family. But I'm glad you're here tonight. Mostly just so we can continue to wade on through Revelation and find our way to the end of the rainbow, as it were. So, as we get started tonight, let us begin our time with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you, Lord, for another chance to come together, to study your word, to study Holy Scripture together. And God, we pray tonight that as we do, that your Spirit be here and guide us, that you speak to us as we study this book, Lord, that though it is very, at times, confusing and confounding, Lord, may you make your message in it known to us, that it may make us better disciples of your Son, Jesus, in whose name we pray. Amen. Can everybody see the screen okay? Good. I'm going to try to, this is my first time using it this way, so this will be fun. And I don't know if we've done this before, but Chris Cheatwood deserves a lot of thanks and credit for getting this set up for us. Looks really good. And it's been... Chris owes me like $20. That's why I decided. No, I'm just kidding. But it does look good, and we're going to be using it tonight. I'm going to be trying to work this little pointer, so if we go backwards, holler at me, and I'll know we're going the right way. So I thought some of you missed the first one, some of you missed the second one, so we're going to do a really quick run through of what we've been talking about. In the first session, we covered seven major questions. Who wrote Revelation? We said John. We gave some possibilities as to which John. But as I'm going to do, as you'll see as we study Revelation, I want to kind of let the book and the internal evidence in it speak and not try to make any kind of assumptions. Though most people would say it is John, John, the son of Zebedee, the youngest, traditionally the youngest disciple of Jesus. But it's John, a wandering prophet in Asia Minor. To whom was Revelation written? The seven churches in Asia Minor. We talked about them last time, and we'll go over that again just for a point of review. From where was it written? From the island of Patmos, a penal colony, a place where John was exiled for his faith. We said for what social function was Revelation written? It was performed orally. It was an oral recitation in a congregational setting. It was not something that was mass-produced. It was not a letter that was passed around to individuals, but something that was read aloud. When was it written? This was kind of the foggiest answer, from the year around the year 80 to the year 120, under the reign of either Domitian or Trajan, with Domitian being probably the heaviest likelihood. For what purpose was Revelation written? We offered some options. The one that I tend to settle on is it is written as anti-assimilation literature, written to Christians in a time when there is pressure from Jews, from Romans, and from former Christians, or we might say backsliding Christians, to become more assimilated with the culture. So Revelation is written to sort of encourage people not to do that. And then we said, what genre is Revelation? We said it is apocalypse, which comes from the Greek word apokalyptos, which is a revealing, where we get the word revelation. It's an uncovering, a message in that has some very specific characteristics and traits that we'll see as we go forward. last time we were together, we talked about the seven churches, and some of the conclusions we drew were that all the churches in Asia Minor, the seven that John is writing to, had pressure from the pagans and the Jews and their culture to assimilate into the culture. They had to deal with internal problems within the churches and within the congregations. This is an early church. One of the things that's hard for us sometimes to wrap our head around is that the early church does not have the sort of foundations that we take for granted both theologically, practically, traditionally, etc. And so they had these problems within the church, particularly a group called the Nicolaitans, who promoted accommodation with the pagan culture for the sake of easier living. And then all the churches faced the seemingly inevitable problems of lethargy and apathy in a time when they're trying to figure out exactly what Jesus meant by some things, trying to figure out exactly what it looks like to be a church. At the same time, the presence of assimilation was common to churches at all economic levels. In the seven churches, we saw the wealthiest churches. We saw some of the poor churches. Christians were not entirely estranged from their surrounding culture, say Christians in certain parts of the world today are, so they were very sort of connected with it. They weren't outlawed necessarily. And the seven letters do not offer us a picture of churches subject to present pervasive state-sponsored persecution. That was kind of a sticking point, I think, for some. But it is what we call the internal evidence, in other words, what the letter actually tells us, and the exterior evidence we have of history, does not suggest to us that there was state-sponsored persecution of Christians during the time of the book of Revelation. There may have been localized persecution, religious persecution from other Jewish sects, or even from other churches, but there was no Roman edict in persecuting churches in Asia Minor. And so the main issue here is conquering. You'll hear that word over and over if you read Revelation, and that means to not assimilate. So, everybody caught up? Everybody good? Okay, well tonight we're going to talk about the seven seals. Ooh, seven seals, right? Okay, and that's, by the way, you know, seals made of wax, not like seals. Okay, just to be sure. Okay. So a general introduction to these, because I think it's important. We're going to talk about the seven seals tonight. Then there will be the seven trumpets, I think followed by the seven bowls. Some interpreters of Revelation see all of these as different events, as 21 events that take place. But one of the key themes, one of the things that's important to understand about apocalyptic literature, and especially about the book of Revelation, is it has a heavy use of recapitulation, which is one of my favorite words to say. I don't know why, it feels nice coming out when you say it. Recapitulation. That is that these seven visions all sort of present the same basic themes, but with a little variation. And you'll notice how they all play out. We've already sort of seen that in the way that the seven letters to the seven churches were written. Each of these visions begins with a scene in heaven. And the reason for that is to reassure the reader that what they're about to see is not some chaotic event that's going to happen, that what John is seeing in this vision and he's relating to them is not some out-of-control nonsense, but that it is actually something that is within the control of God. And so tonight we're going to look at these first two visions, and then you'll notice that they focus on a word that you've heard before called the tribulation. We're going to talk about that word in a little while, just because, for the most part, I think it's kind of been abused a bit. You'll hear folks say stuff, oh my gosh, milk is $4 a gallon, it's the tribulation, you know, stuff like that, and that's just silly talk. And so one of the primary themes to understand in all of these visions is that God is in control of what's happening. Now, I thought about maybe trying to chase the theological rabbit of, if God is in control, does that mean God is the cause of something? But I'm not going to do that because we don't have time. So I want you to think about that question. If God is in control, does that mean that God is the cause of something? I'm not going to tell you what my answer is because I want you to have your own. So tonight we're going to start with these dual scenes in heaven, in Revelation chapter 4 and 5. And I want to read both of these, starting with chapter 4. They're pretty short, and so relatively short. And I think it's important to read them and hear them. So Revelation chapter 4 begins this way. Now John is having this vision, and he says, "After this I looked up, and there in heaven a door stood open. And the first voice, which I had heard speaking to me like a trumpet, said, 'Come here, and I will show you what must take place after this.' At once I was in the Spirit, and there in heaven stood a throne, with one seated on the throne. And the one seated there looks like jasper and carnelian, and around the throne is a rainbow that looks like an emerald. Around the throne are 24 thrones, and seated on the thrones are 24 elders, dressed in white robes with golden crowns on their heads. Coming from the throne are flashes of lightning and rumblings and peals of thunder. And in front of the throne burn seven flaming torches, which are the seven spirits of God. And in front of the throne there is something like a sea of glass, like crystal. Around the throne and on each side of the throne are four living creatures, full of eyes in front and behind. The first living creature like an ox, the first living creature like a lion, the second living creature like an ox, the third living creature with a face like a human face, and the fourth living creature like a flying eagle. And the four living creatures, each of them with six wings, are full of eyes all around and inside. Day and night, without ceasing, they sing, "Holy, holy, holy, the Lord God, the Almighty, who was and is to come." And whenever the living creatures give glory and honor and thanks to the one who is seated on the throne, who lives forever and ever, the 24 elders fall before the one who is seated on the throne and worship the one who lives forever and ever. They cast their crowns before the throne, singing, "You are worthy, our Lord and God, to receive glory and honor and power, for you created all things, and by you, by your will, they existed and were created." So you get that image? Pretty normal stuff, right? See it all the time. Well, here's, I think this is a little better image, though. Can you all see that kind of good? It's kind of hard to see, but it's a vision, right? And so, but here, maybe this will help. Here are the elders seated on a throne. There's seven lamps in the spirit. This is the emerald rainbow here, the living being with peals of lightning. And then these four creatures, the eagle, the human, the ox, and the lion, and their six wings. So here in chapter 4 is a glimpse of heavenly worship. Now, where else have you heard some of these symbols before, if you're brushed up on your scripture? Where are some other places you've heard images like this or description like this? Daniel? Good. Ezekiel? Isaiah 6? Isaiah is taken up into heaven and he sees the throne room of God. So, it's important to understand this is not unique, nor is it new to the book of Revelation. In fact, what happens, these four creatures here are often the source of speculation and wild interpretation. But the truth is, even in John's day, even in the first century, these four creatures would have been understood to be seraphim, the highest ranking order of angels. And what's interesting to note now is church tradition has used them to talk about the four Gospels. There's Matthew, there's John, there's Luke, and there's Mark. Oh, sorry, Mark, Matthew, Luke, and John. That's how they're sort of, and then it all has to do with how they depict Jesus, but the church down through the history has sort of taken those images and applied them to the four Gospels. So here's this image of heaven. Here are all the host of heaven, the high council here. They're all praising God. This is the image of heaven. This is where it starts. The images, the vision we're about to see, begins in heaven, and it begins with worship of one who is worthy of worship, one who is holy, 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 the angels sing three times, as they do in Isaiah 6. And these elders, there are different interpretations for them. There are 24, so some think it's the 12 tribes of Israel, maybe the 12 disciples, although you forget Judas probably isn't going to be sitting there, and so then that creates a little bit of a problem. But as we hear numbers in Revelation, we talked a little bit about numbers, didn't we, before? I'm forgetting. It's been a while. There's some important numbers to remember any time you talk about Judeo-Christian apocalyptic literature. 3 and 4. 3 is the divine number. 4 is the human number. Now think about all these other numbers that come into play. What's 3 plus 4? 7, that's the number of perfection. 3 times 4. 3 times 4, 12. Okay. Okay, yeah. This is church. Okay. Maybe we should study the book of Numbers. That's a bad joke, wasn't it? That's bad. Okay, anyway. So that's just something to remember when you hear numbers. in the book. And so if seven's a number of perfection, six is just shy of it. You repeat stuff three times for emphasis. So six, six score, and six, 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 six is a fault of perfection. So anyway, we'll cross that bridge when we get there, but that just kind of whets your palate. So here's the image, heavenly worship. It's important to understand that one of the descriptions that John gives is of this, a rainbow-like emerald. He specifically uses the word rainbow. What do you know about a rainbow in the history of Scripture and in the Judeo-Christian tradition? Noah. It's a promise of what? Yeah, it's a promise of not being angry, right? So it's important to understand that in the first vision we have of John and describing these things that are to come, he is emphatic to describe an image and a symbol of God's peace. I think that's important. Okay, so the next, and it's also important to understand too, though I don't think anybody would really think this, but some do. In the second verse of chapter 4, we hear about John being taken into heaven. Some have interpreted this to be a verse about the rapture. You really got to stretch to try to make it a verse about something like a rapture. I think it's kind of irresponsible to read verse 2 of chapter 4 as the church rising to heaven when it's very clearly about John rising to heaven. So that brings us back to chapter 5 now. Now, in chapter 5, I won't read all of that there, but in chapter 5, essentially what happens is there is a problem now that appears in heaven. There's a scroll, and no one seems willing, able, or worthy to open the scroll. And so, in verse 4, John says he begins to weep bitterly because no one was found worthy to open the scroll or the book to look into it. And then one of the elders said, "Do not weep. See, the Lion of the tribe of Judah, the Root of David, has conquered so that he can open the scroll and its seven seals." And then I saw in verse 6, between the throne and the four living creatures and among the elders, a lamb standing as if it had been slaughtered, having seven horns and seven eyes, which are the seven spirits of God sent out into all the earth. He went and took the scroll from the right hand of the one who was seated on the throne, the right hand being the hand of power. When he had taken the scroll, the four living creatures and the 24 elders fell before the Lamb, each holding a harp and golden bowls full of incense, which are the prayers of the saints, and they sing a new song. "You are worthy to take the scroll and to open its seals, for you were slaughtered, and by your blood you ransomed for God saints from every tribe and language and people and nation. You have made them to be a kingdom and priests serving our God, and they will reign on earth." So now the elders and these creatures begin to sing a new song because the Lamb who is Jesus, that's good. All right, there's Jesus, right? I mean, this is one of the earliest symbols we have of Jesus is the shepherd and the slaughtered lamb. And so it's clear to the early Christians who are reading this, this is Christ. Christ is found to be the only one worthy to open the book or the scroll. Now, what's the significance of this book or scroll? Well, in order to understand that, I wanted you to kind of get this. In the ancient world, especially in ancient Judeo-Christian understanding, there were sort of three ways to talk about God's sovereignty. As you can imagine, this is a difficult thing sometimes for us to talk about. Calvin stressed it and really thought it was very important, as did Augustine way before him, and some even do now. And then there are others who say, well, maybe there are people called open theists who say, well, God's not really sovereign over time, and time moves ahead of God, and so God is playing all of this the same way we are. But in the ancient world, there were three ways of understanding God's sovereignty. One was this sort of God had foreknowledge, that God is God and can see down the road. God's not controlling it. God can see it. This is actually how I tend to think. I'll just pull the curtain back. This is how I tend to think about God. God has foreknowledge. It's kind of like how most of you, if you're a kid, if you tell them you can't have a cookie, you know in the back of your mind, though, that they're going to what? Want a cookie, right? It's the same thing. It's not you've told them to want a cookie and then you didn't let them have one. You just know. So one way of understanding it is God, in his omnipotence and in his omnipresence and omniscience, has foreknowledge and knows. A second way is that God has actively preordained things to happen. And this means that God has said, this is what's going to happen, this is what's going to happen, then this is what's going to happen. The most, probably the most brilliant, really, even though I disagree with him sometimes, American theologian was Jonathan Edwards. You all probably know Jonathan Edwards, right? Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. Edwards' way of understanding God's foreordination was an understanding that everything has a consequence. And so that means, since everything has a consequence, you and I are the result of a consequence, which means our actions will be therefore informed by the consequence of which we are a result. And so we're not really in control of anything because it's all been formed before us. And it all goes back. And Edwards could never explain the fall. Edwards couldn't explain Adam. So anyway, that's my fault with Edwards. But that's one way of understanding it. Everything is preordained. God has laid it out. We're on a track, and you can't get off of it. A third way was that God's will was written down prior to creation. God's plan, God's ways, laying everything out, was written down prior to creation in a book or a scroll, which was then sealed by God and only to be opened by someone who is worthy, and it will release God's will on the earth. There are actually other extra-biblical texts that talk about this, how God basically laid out his plan, and then Christ, before the foundations of the world, as we hear Paul talk about, opened the scroll. Some even think John may not be seeing the future, but may actually be seeing the past in the book of Revelation. So, without really being too obvious, it's this third way that we hear expressed in Revelation 5 of a scroll that is being presented in heaven, and no one seems worthy to open it. So now, I want us to talk about the scroll and the seven seals. But before we do, I want to be very clear that the point of the first two sort of scenes in heaven are for anyone who's hearing the book of Revelation to understand that God is in control of this. This is all starting with God. And the God who is in control of this is a God who is gracious. A God who has a rainbow, a sign of redemption around his throne, a lamb who has been slaughtered, that this is not a God who is angry. This is not a God who is allowing chaos to rule the world. This is not a God, excuse me, who, like the gods of the Greeks or the other Mesopotamian cultures, was sitting up on a throne on a mountain waiting to get rid of humans. It is important to understand that in the beginning two scenes in heaven are God, and to remind us that God is a God of benevolence. So now we're going to look at the four, the seven seals, and we're going to start with the four horsemen. Anybody remember? Woo! Yeah, anybody else remember the four horsemen? All right, good. I was hoping somebody else would remember. That was back in the day when wrestling was wrestling. Okay. Sorry, you're going to have to look at that for a little while because I don't have another slide after that. That's not true. Everybody knows who the four horsemen are? Anybody want to explain? That's Ric Flair. That's Ric Flair, Sid Vicious. Yeah, Arn Anderson. Yeah, there you go. There you go. Yeah, so the Nature Boy right there. That's right, yeah. As you can tell, I'm styling my hair after Ric Flair. It's going that way. I just wanted to have some fun with Four Horsemen. Anyway, we'll talk about the first one. This is a more serious picture of the Four Horsemen. Now, we've all heard about the Four Horsemen, right? That's usually the image people think of when they think about the book of Revelation. The thing about the Four Horsemen is they're only given eight verses. Did you know that? There are only eight verses that describe the Four Horsemen. They're the first four seals that are broken on the scroll that the Lamb takes. So the first seal is the white horse. Now, many people see the white horse and think, oh my gosh, it's Jesus, because Jesus comes later on a white horse. I don't think so. In fact, this image is actually misleading because it shows him with an arrow. Some people have read that when you read Revelation, I don't believe it says he has an arrow. It just says he has a bow. Some people say that it lacks an arrow means it's a bow of peace. Really, I think it's like saying, somebody's got a gun. Oh, it didn't say he had bullets. It doesn't really matter. The first horseman is riding on a white horse. He carries a bow. Romans... Excuse me, citizens of the Roman Empire in the first century When they hear about a guy on a horse with a bow, Parthians come to mind. The Parthian warriors who defeated the Romans on several occasions because of their advances in things like mounted archers. So when they think about these mounted archers, you see a white horse come in, a guy riding with a bow. This is a symbol of a war of conquest. Somebody who's coming in to conquer, to take over everything. And so this is the first horseman, conquest, riding on a white horse. The second is the red horse. Now the red horse is a symbol of internal anarchy among the nations, a catalyst for people to slay one another. The red horse is a symbol of anarchy. It's a symbol that's saying these things that are to come, there's not going to be, it's just going to be chaotic and out of control. And so that's the second horseman. The third horseman is the black horse. Now the black horse, this is what it says about the black horse in verse 6. I heard what seemed to be a voice in the midst of the four living creatures. Remember, John is seeing this in the midst of this heavenly scene. A quart of wheat for a day's pay and three quarts of barley for a day's pay, but do not damage the olive oil and the wine. Now, that sounds kind of cryptic to us, but essentially, it's a declaration that says a worker is going to have to spend everything they make just to eat. There's no room left for rent. There's no room left for anything else. They're going to have to spend all of their money that they make on food. Now, I think it's worth noting, though I haven't read this anywhere else, so this is my own input. Maybe somebody else said it, but you can take it for just that. It's my own input. I think it's worth noting that the black horse, who symbolizes famine, is not marked by something like a drought. That the horse of famine is not marked by a natural disaster that destroys the crops in the world, but rather is marked by the price of food. Did you notice that in verse 6, like I just read? A quart of wheat for a day's pay, three quarts of barley for a day's pay. The black horse is marked by the cost of food, which is controlled by us, people. I think that's important, and I think it's interesting. But the black horse comes in symbolizing famine. Now, the fourth and final horse, somebody, if you all have different versions, what color is it in your Bible? Pale green. Horse of a different color? Does it really say that? Oh, I was like, it would be a horse of a different color. Any other colors? Pale. Ashen is sometimes written. Yeah. Yeah, sometimes it's just green, sometimes it's gray. I mean, it's really a sickly-looking horse is the idea. The fourth green, the pale green horse is death. And it's pretty blunt and to the point, actually, that the fourth horse is death because it says death followed it. So the four horsemen, the four seals, the first four seals are conquest, anarchy, famine, and death. These things that seem to be out of control, things that seem to be really full of violence and things that are really just turning the world upside down, they symbolize the great tribulation of Jewish and Christian expectation. Now, it's important to hear me when I say that, of Jewish and Christian expectation, because the tribulation was something that was actually... It was actually something that was being waited for by both Jews and early Christians. So these are just up here for my own sake so I can see them, but if you can see them, that's good too. I wanted to sort of give you an idea of how the Jewish expectation for tribulation and the early Christian expectation for tribulation compared and contrasted. Jews believed that the tribulation was a period of suffering before the end. And for Jews, that meant the actual end, the end of the age. Later on, in a couple hundred years, really after the time maybe of Malachi, so about 400 years maybe before Jesus, or really probably, Daniel is actually pretty late. Daniel comes around maybe 100 years before Jesus, or maybe 300 years in the time of Alexander the Great and the Greeks taking over Judaism. But it's about that time, somewhere in that era, between the Greeks taking over
capturing Persia and all that stuff, to about 100 years or up to the time of Jesus. The Jewish faith underwent a lot of changes. It was influenced a lot by the Greeks, by the Zoroastrians. It was influenced, this is where some of the Christian ideas that we have that are not in the Hebrew Bible actually come from. And so some of these ideas about things like tribulation come out of this period. And they believe that this was a period of suffering before the end. It could, however, have taken place in the past. It could take place in the present, or it could be something down the line in the future. God's people suffer. Gentiles suffer. And both suffer, with God's people being predicted or protected. The length of this tribulation varied depending on what stream of Judaism there was. The primary concern, though, was, not primary concern, but it was of primary concern for some. In other words, for some people, for some Jews living in that era, tribulation was a really important thing. They talked about it all the time. For others, it was like, there might be one. And for some, they could care less whether there was one or not. They didn't necessarily believe there was. For Jews, it functioned as a test for Israel, for repentance for the Gentiles, or for judgment for all. Now, you see how the Christians compared to this. They believe it was a period of suffering before the shift of the ages. One of the things that we've kind of forgotten about early Christians is they didn't actually think things were just going to shut down and end. They believed that there was going to be an actual shift in the age. They get this from their actual Jewish roots, that there was going to be a continuation, a shift in the ages, that the earth wasn't going to get flushed down the toilet, everything wasn't going to end in a big ball of fire, but that God was actually going to move things. This is what Jesus came in actually saying, right? The kingdom of God is at hand. There's a shift coming in the ages. For early Christians, the tribulation obviously did not take place in the past, but it could happen in the present, or it could happen in the future. Now, this is important, this third point. God's people would suffer, or both Christians and non-Christians would suffer. So often when we hear about the tribulation in our sort of context, we usually hear about it from a premillennial perspective, which means that God's people are going to be taken out, and that word that's usually been tossed around is raptured, that God's people will be raptured, and then all hell breaks loose on earth, but it's okay because all of God's people have a front row seat up in heaven while it happens. This is not the perspective of early Christians. It's not the perspective of many Christians today. I'm one of them. Because when I read the scriptures, God's people seem to always be in the midst of suffering. Christ actually calls us to suffer. And as we'll read in Revelation, it seems that God's people are also called to suffer. So, when the early Christians thought about the tribulation, this was not something from which to be rescued, but which we would endure with God's protection. So the length of this thing is of little concern to early Christians. It could last a week. It could last symbolically a week, which could be any length of time. It was not very little. God may shorten it if he chooses so out of his own mercy. And Christian watchfulness was its primary interest, as we hear over and over and over again. Be alert. Stay awake. Be on the watch. This is the point of the tribulation. Not that God just wants to watch everybody like suffer, but it's a motivation to be on alert and to look out. So does all that kind of make sense? Good, because it doesn't to me. But no, I'm just kidding. Okay. Here's what we see in Revelation about the tribulation. It's in the imminent future. And so that means when? Anytime, right? It's in the future. It could be in the next hour. It could be in 1,000 years. But it's important to understand it's before the parousia, the second return of Christ. It will be upon both God's people and the Gentiles. Revelation does not have God's people removed from this. But God's people are given special protection in the midst of it, that God will see them through it. He seals them, we hear. It lasts for a certain time. We're given a time frame, though some have read it symbolically and in different ways. For Christians, it's a test. It's a motivation for faithfulness. This is what we see throughout Revelation. For non-Christians, it serves as an opportunity to repent, though it is not likely taken. So there's the real quick rundown on the tribulation. Everything you ever wanted to know about the tribulation, we're afraid to ask, now you know. So there you go. Actually, that's not everything there is to know, and half of it, it came from me, so who knows. So here we get to the fifth seal. This is sealing. This is the image of the martyrs under the altar of God. Now, these martyrs are in an interesting place. They're in this sort of intermediate state. They're not fully resurrected, but they're also not actual people prior to death suffering. They have died on earth, but they're in this odd sort of purgatory-ish state beneath the altar of God. Now, it's characteristic of apocalyptic literature to assume that God has ordained a certain number of martyrs before the end of the age. This happens a lot in apocalyptic literature, the idea that there are going to have to be some people to die for the sake of the message, for the sake of the movement. And so, one of the things that Charles Talbert says here about the fifth seal is that it shows that the tribulation, symbolized again by the four horsemen, will include the martyrdom of believers. That some believers will actually be martyred. And that it was characteristic of apocalyptic thought to assume that God, again, had foreordained a certain number of martyrdoms that must be accomplished before he would intervene to bring an end to the present evil age. So this is almost like if John was writing the apocalypse, he'd said, oh yeah, there's got to be some martyrs. Where does that take place? How does that happen? It's very common in apocalyptic literature, and it's a very common way of understanding. One of the marks of it was martyrdom of the saints. So that's the fifth seal. And then the sixth seal is this cosmic disturbance. So we have human suffering in the martyrs, followed immediately by cosmic disturbance before the day of the Lord. Now, it's important, I think, to notice here that Luke 21 is actually the closest gospel correlation to what we see taking place in Revelation. And this is just a rabbit I'm going to chase for a minute. And I tell people in Tuesday Bible study, it's a slow, fat rabbit, so I'll catch it in a hurry. One of the things I think that happens when we talk about Revelation is there are some people who would rather use Revelation as a lens through which to read the rest of the Bible. And usually they're reading an interpretation of Revelation and using that as a lens through which to read the whole of Scripture. So they'll read Revelation, and then when they go back to read the Gospels, they go, aha, here's the connecting point to Revelation. I don't think that's really a responsible way to read Scripture. But also, I think it's important to understand with all of Scripture, both the Hebrew canon and the New Testament, that a lot of these books don't know about the other books. Do you understand what I mean by that? That Revelation, when John was on Patmos writing Revelation, he probably had never read James' epistle. Or he may not have read anything Paul had written to any of the churches. He likely knew Paul because they probably crossed paths at Ephesus. But you know what I'm saying. He probably didn't actually sit down and go, oh, you know what? We need one more book in the New Testament. Let me write this thing down. It's important to understand that while the letters of the New Testament and the books of the Old Testament do have common themes and are in some ways connected, they are not interdependent upon one another. That makes sense? That's my biblical studies rant, and I'm done. Okay. So, but I do think it's important to notice those connections, but not to read them through the lens of another. So, what we see happening in this sixth seal is a lot of what we call the Day of Yahweh language. This comes from actually the Old Testament. We see with like prophets like Amos and others who talk about this coming day of the Lord. Well, the Jews had basically, or the Christians had inherited this language and these ideas from the ancient Jews about a coming day of the Lord. But what's interesting is when you read the prophets, some of them talk about the Day of Yahweh as a terrible, dark, destructive day. And then they turn right around and talk about it as this bright, brilliant, wonderful day that's coming. I think that's not an accident that John borrows that language when he talks about the sixth seal and this cosmic disturbance. Yes, there are all these things that happen. Earthquakes, the sun is darkened, moon turns to blood, stars fall like figs, sky rolls up like a scroll, it vanishes, mountains and islands are moved. But if we keep in mind the same language that's used in the prophets, we know that this is not dark doom and gloom in the end, but there's coming something after this. It may be important to note, may not, so I'm not going to say a whole lot about it, but he says the stars fall and he uses language like figs out of the sky. Keep in mind, this is in a day before they knew what stars actually were. And so there's some historical things to take into concept, into consideration there. Now, what happens next is actually not the opening of the seventh seal. There's an interlude that takes place. In chapter 7, in the 17, in chapter 17, verses 1 through 17. One of them is the sealing of the 144,000. Think about that number for a minute. What's significant? What numbers do you know are part of 144,000? 12, which is divided by 3, 4 divided by 4, 3 that we went over. So you see those numbers sneaking back in, right? He lists the 12 tribes, but Dan is omitted of the 12. I haven't heard any interesting reason why that is. It's just interesting to note that Dan is omitted from the talking of the 12 tribes. These who are sealed to protect them through the tribulation, in other words, the divine retribution for the four winds that we see in there. Also in Revelation, they represent the full number of believers alive when this tribulation takes place. Now, to talk about perhaps Elvin in the room, you all know what you probably are familiar with the Jehovah's Witnesses and this idea that 144,000 in the book of Revelation are the Jehovah's Witnesses. Historically, when Jehovah's Witnesses began, they thought when we reach 144,000, the end will come. And then they reached 144,001. And I think that was sometime in the 70s. And they were just like, what do we do? And so they changed then, I don't know now. And I don't mean any disrespect to them, really. But they changed and said, well, what it means is when there are 144,000 of the sort of truest of Jehovah's Witnesses, then the end will come. So if you've heard that connection before, that's where it's from. It's from here. I think there was a NBC tried to do a TV show, I think, called The 144,000 at one time. That was a play off this, but I don't even know what it was about. Maybe aliens? I don't know. Anyway, it's interesting to note that there's a pause here to talk about the sealing of these 144,000, and what they actually represent is the number of believers alive when this tribulation takes place. Now, that number being divisible by 12, 3, and 4 can be seen as symbolic, or it can be understood that this is a large number in the first century for someone to think in terms of a population. So there's also this celebration in heaven and an explanation of it. These people celebrating represent the church triumphant. So it's kind of a pause button in the midst of all these things that sound bad to remind you, hey, things aren't all going that bad. As Talbert says, this is about Christian faithfulness, while the human act is enabled by grace. This is not something that we ourselves are able to accomplish. So we get to the seventh seal. And the seventh seal is silence. A lot of build up to the seventh. A lot of things going on. Four horsemen, cosmic disturbance, martyrs under the altar of God, a giant, enormous scene of worship going on in heaven, a lot of noise. If you can imagine it, even that beginning scene in heaven with all the elders, with everyone shouting and singing, even the four creatures, all these things are taking place, and then silence. There's this great anticipation that's about to take place as the seventh seal is broken. It's this dramatic pause. I can even imagine as they were reading Revelation out loud, somebody probably wrote over in the margin, like, pause right here. Pause. The silence is reminiscent of the silence before pre-creation, while the spirits hovered over the waters we see in Genesis. And it's the end of the first seven visions. God is in control. The Lamb sets into motion God's plan on earth, and God protects his people through the tribulation, not outside of the tribulation. And so that brings me to the things to come away with, because there's a lot packed in here, and I know we didn't read a lot of it, but that's a lot to read in Revelation. Two real big things to come away with, anytime actually through Revelation, but specifically in these first seven seals. God is in control of history. Whether that means he is actually foreordaining and manipulating the paths that people are taking, or whether that means that God is making sure it doesn't get out of hand and outside of the realm of control and redemption. God is in control of history, and that Christ, the crucified Lamb, is the one who is able to bring about God's will in history. That's because of those first two scenes that we saw. We start there and keep in mind those two scenes throughout the opening of these seals and the next recapitulation with the trumpets and the bowls, that we understand that God is ultimately in control of all this. And Christ is the one who is opening these seals, allowing these things to happen, who is the one bringing God's will on earth. And ultimately God's will is that everyone would know who he is, that everyone would come to be in a relationship with him. So that's running through the seven seals of Revelation. I thought about trying to sing that song, you know, about John the Revelator and the book, but I'm not singing it. I meant like all of us together. But anyway, so let us end our time together. Will anybody have any questions? This might be biting myself. Anybody have any questions? Good. Okay. Oh, Jimmy, you have a question? Just one. Okay. I may not have an answer. I probably don't have an answer.
Well, there may be an answer, but I don't know if I know it. You said when Jesus was born, the shepherds came to John on Patmos. There wasn't any persecution by the Roman government.
Right, there's no evidence of it.
Who sent him to prison?
Yeah, now John may have been sent to Patmos prior to the writing of Revelation. There was definitely persecution under, say, Nero in around the years, the 60s. There's definitely persecution. Yeah, I'm sorry. That's something we covered in the first one. I meant to say there was definitely eras of state-sponsored Christian persecution. In fact, we all know, like, Constantine, right, in the 3rd century, legalized Christianity. He didn't actually make it the state religion of the empire. He just legalized it. But even after Constantine legalizes Christianity, there are actually still spells of Roman state-appointed persecution of Christians. So these things still take place. So there, it comes and goes and ebbs and flows, and just like there was state-appointed persecution of Jews even in that time. So no, that's a good question. And John may have been exiled to Patmos from somewhere other than Asia Minor as well. There may have been state-appointed persecution in other parts of the empire. So good. All right.
I have one question.
Okay.
Revelation is always giving you problems.
You ain't by yourself.
It says a study of the most misunderstood book of the Bible.
That's right. Yeah.
Why is it so misunderstood? I mean, we
you read it, right?
Brave to know it, know about it, but we don't understand it.
Yeah. Well, I think it's a good question. I think because when I say that, I mean, there's a historical record of just how misunderstood and confusing Revelation is because, I mean, even at the Council of Nicaea in the 4th century or the Council of Hippo or Constantinople, it always came up, right? Do we really want to keep this in the canon? I mean, there's so many other books, the Shepherd of Hermas, the Didache. There are other books that could have made it into the New Testament that make sense. Do we really want to keep Revelation? I mean, do we really want an apocalypse in the Christian New Testament? And so even from the beginning, Revelation is this controversial book because everyone's thinking, why is this here? Well, this is malarkey. This is crazy. We try to read this, we don't understand it. But the fact that it had survived for 3 centuries or 4 centuries or even 6 centuries, by the time that people were trying to decide on the canon, the fact that it had survived that long said something to them, that this is before the age of the printing press, before things could be saved digitally and all that stuff. So they're thinking, well, there's a reason why more people have heard of Revelation, and perhaps this is the Spirit. So they kept it. But it still causes frustration. You can go back and look at some of the patristics, some of the church fathers and the collections of their sermons. They never touch Revelation. They don't want anything to do with it. You get to the Reformation, and Luther says, it's crazy, let's leave it out, I don't want anything to do with it. You have John Calvin, who's probably the most brilliant Protestant theologian, though, again, not my cup of tea, but really it's hard to argue with how brilliant he was, writes a volume of commentary on all other 65 books of the Bible, but doesn't do it on Revelation. because revelation is this source of frustration and misunderstanding and mystery. But then for some reason in the 20th century and even the late 19th century, American Western Christianity, this revivalist Christianity takes hold of it and begins to read Revelation and say, this is about us, which is what every generation had done before. But it takes hold because now there's a technological boom, the Industrial Revolution takes place, and things seem to really, man, this really seems like the end. And then the Great War happens, World War I. World War I happens. Man, we're living in the end times. I mean, we're literally going to war with one another. Then World War II happens. And in the midst of World War II and the atrocities they see there, man, this really must be about us. And then we drop two atomic bombs on Japan. And we realize we are the wielders of hell and death. And so now we go, oh my gosh, we can really read Revelation. I mean, this is really about us. And it happens, you know, every time something like that happens. But it's become more intense as now, too, the world has gotten smaller. And we realize we actually hold the power to end the world. And so, man, I've chased that rabbit a long way. But, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's true, yeah.
What we feel.
But the lectionary leaves it out a lot, yeah.
To think, well, all this is so strong, you know, put out the figures in their horsemen and all that. Am I on the right track? Personally, you know what I mean? Where am I in this thing? And we better look at Jesus more closely, don't we?
Well, I think that's, I honestly think that's the point of Revelation, is it is a, it's not supposed to be this puzzle we're supposed to put together, and then when we get to the end of it, go, aha, we got it all figured out. I see the vision clearly now. I know dates. I know times. I know people. I think the point of Revelation is to call us to always be alert, not so we're looking for signs and trying to put the puzzle together, but so that we protect our faith and understand that what Christ has called us to is this sort of radical way of living, because it is very easy, and as I think we witnessed today, it's very easy to sort of slide into a culture that says, like ours does today, that it's Christian. It's real easy to assimilate into something when it's branded to you and marked as, this is the Christian way. So really, in some ways, I think Revelation is a more relevant book than ever, but not because I think that the world's going to end, but because I really do think that Christians are more at risk now of becoming assimilated into a culture that has convinced us that it's Christian than ever before. That makes sense. And so, do you get what I'm saying? So I think you're right. I think when you read Revelation, part of it is to say, man, maybe I ought to wake up to some of this. And am I really following Christ, or am I following a Christ that somebody has convinced me is Christ? Yeah, I mean, that's the point in a nutshell. Yeah, be awake. Be alert. All the apocalyptic in the Gospels from Jesus, that's the point. Be awake. Be alert. And as I've said, I think in other cases, while Revelation is textbook apocalyptic literature, my apocalyptic understanding is always Matthew 25. I mean, it's a call to be awake, alert, and to do what Christ has called us to do, and not get tied up in trying to be comfortable, not get tied up in trying to find signs, but trying to be doing what Christ has called us to do in the midst of our lives now. So I believe I'll take up an offering after that. Yeah. Good question, Dor. Anybody else? All right, well, let's end our time together then with a word of prayer. Lord Jesus, we thank you for another chance to come together, Lord, to study your word. And God, we thank you that even though sometimes it can be hard to understand, even though sometimes it is confusing, or that it is still life-giving, and still points us to you and your truth, still calls us to this life of faith. So, Lord, may the words that we've studied tonight, words that we've heard this morning in Sunday school, words in our own private times of prayer, or that we've heard, words that stand out to us in Scripture, that call to us. May those words shape us, Lord, from this day forward more and more into the likeness of your Son, Jesus, our King, our friend, our Savior, in whose name we pray. Amen.